Europe is under siege from the violent depths of the earth. From every angle, at every boundary, it's being pushed and tugged, gashed and scarred by rock and fire. How do these mighty forces rule this land? And what does living in a place under constant assault mean for millions? Our planet is locked in an epic battle, a battle fought deep below ground. The tectonic plates that make the Earth's crust are constantly moving, bumping and jostling, pulling and tugging each other, fighting for turf. When plates collide, they can raise mountains. When they tear apart, a fiery display. The massive Eurasian plate bears combat scars on all sides. All along this plate's edges are forces yielding unimaginable power. But where does all this power come from? For answers, geologists come to Iceland. Straddling the border between the North American and Eurasian plates, Iceland is a geologic powerhouse. But the island wasn't the center of anyone's attention until the spring of 2010. The volcano, Eyjafjallajökull, on the southern end of Iceland, started spewing ash for the first time in 200 years. Instantly, Iceland was front page news. A plume shot 30,000 feet into the air, making a cloud of ash that spread for thousands of miles and halted air traffic in much of Europe for 6 days. The ash so thick it could choke a jet engine. It was the biggest disruption in air travel since 9/11. But for Iceland, Eyjafjallajökull is a small eruption. Big one could be just around the corner. Here, the glaciers sit on top of volcanoes, like icy lids on cooking pots. When an eruption begins, the pots boil over, the lids lift off, sending floods of ash and lava everywhere, exploding with enough force to twist these steel girders from a highway bridge like pipe cleaners. Glaciers are the Jekyll and Hyde of Iceland. On one hand, they regulate volcanic activity, attempting to keep the pots from simmering over. But on the other hand, when the heat of the eruption melts the ice, disaster is magnified.
Can smell the sulfur, so you know there is a volcano underneath here.
To see firsthand the chaos created when the plates rip apart, Canadian geologist Nick Iles travels to one of the smaller Icelandic glaciers that hides a sinister secret. It's a volcano named Katja. Local geologist Kristen Gudjonsson is his guide.
Yes. We've got to remind ourselves all the time of that. There's an active or quiet volcano right underneath the ice.
Or maybe not so quiet.
It's simmering.
Simmering. Ready to go.
If Katla went off, the explosion would be an estimated 10 times stronger than Eyjafjallajökull. For now, the glacier over Katla is keeping a snug cap on the crater. But that won't always be the case. Iceland is constantly changing because it is still being formed.
There's nowhere stable on the Earth's surface today. Everywhere is moving. I think it's important to bring people out into natural landscapes and explain how that landscape got developed.
Iceland rose from the sea only 8 million years ago, pushed up by the grinding and bumping of the North American and Eurasian plates. Now it straddles a hot spot, the Icelandic plume, a constant flow of magma coming from the core of the Earth. Its location makes Iceland a seismic bullseye. Here, It's like walking across the ocean floor on dry land. Nowhere else in the world can geologists walk across the landscape and at the same time study how the sea floor is spreading due to magma coming up. And the magma is the fuel of plate tectonics. Here, scalding mud holes, heated from deep within the earth, are everywhere. The crust here is so thin that walking on it is extremely dangerous.
So we are at the leading edge of the North American plate. And yep. If we just go over there, over the ridge actually.
It's only a 5 minutes drive to Europe here.
Iceland exposes a process that is going on continually along the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean. The floor is always spreading along a mid-ocean ridge.
A moonscape would be the word to describe this.
Yeah, it's a landscape which otherwise you can't see because it's underneath the ocean.
Yeah.
The only place where the ridge comes up for air is Iceland. Geologists flock here because they can actually see the bottom of the ocean. This is an actual glimpse at how new landmasses are born. As new land is born, tectonic plates are pushed apart, rearranging continents.
As we knew more about the ocean floor, as we knew more about the center lines of the ocean, such as what we see in Iceland, where new crust is being added, and that addition is pushing the plates aside, as that information got added to geology information, it became completely clear that the continents had migrated as part of plates.
The plates have their own system of movement. They come together, they break apart. What moves the continents is the growth and wear of tectonic plates. This is where plates are being built. Magma from the deep pushes the plates apart, growing new land. This place is called Thingvellir. The path below marks where the plates meet. Professor Freistein Sigmundsson takes regular measurements here. He's keeping track of how fast the plates are separating.
The rate of plate movements here in Iceland is about the same as the rate of the growth of your fingernail. So when we come back after a year, we can measure the spreading. In Iceland, this is 2 centimeters per year.
And we're looking out across a big rift valley, which is the boundary with Europe.
Yes.
And you're measuring the rate at which North American plate is being pushed to the west.
Yes, exactly. Regular measurements have been conducted here since the acceptance of plate tectonics in the 1960s.
So if it wasn't for the Icelandic plume, all this would be underwater. This would be part of the North Atlantic Ridge and we wouldn't see it.
Yeah, we would be 3 kilometers below sea level.
Land grows extremely quickly here, showing just how unstable this landscape is. Iceland's place right on top of a plate boundary means that it's very seismically active, a dark cloud to live under. But is there a silver lining to taking the risk? The massive Eurasian plate is at the mercy of plate tectonics. On its east and south, smaller plates are constantly ramming it, forcing it to buckle. On its western end, it's violently pushing away from its neighbor, leaving Iceland in the crosswire. But it's armed with hidden power. And all this power is coming from just underground. Iceland's location on top of a tectonic rift, where magma is constantly pushing up, along with an incredibly thin crust, makes this place extremely volatile, and in some ways, very fortunate.
This is basically steam. This is a high temperature hot spring area, so it's steam that comes from the ground They use that steam to heat up cold groundwater, which they then pipe to the town. And we are going more and more into generating electricity with geothermal steam rather than hydro.
And presumably there's an unlimited supply of geothermal energy.
Yeah.
A renewable resource, yeah. Courtesy of plate tectonics.
For the next 1,000 million years, at least.
Yeah. Now, presumably the next lava flow is going to wipe the plant out.
Yeah, possibly, very possibly.
Or a fissure might open up below it.
And this is simply the risk you have to take. We are living on a volcano.
Iceland isn't on top of just one volcano. It rides a plume of magma equal to dozens of volcanic eruptions, which puts it right on top of a staggering amount of geologic power. And all that raw power is being turned into energy.
So, this is an excellent example of the raw energy we are tapping into underneath here. This is a borehole which is flowing now, and it produces 19 megawatts.
19 megawatts is roughly the same amount of power generated by four electric locomotives. When they first tap one of these boreholes, it explodes with so much force that engineers have to let it blow off steam for weeks until they can cap it with high-pressure pipe.
So this is only happening here because we're near the edge of the plate. It's very thin, we're close to the mantle source, and the rocks are really fractured, so the water drives down and it comes up superheated.
Yes, yes. And if we wouldn't have a muffler on this, we wouldn't be able to stand here. The sound would be so close our hearing in seconds.
There are few places in the world where you could do this. Drill right through the crust and plug into the energy.
Quite literally, this is drilling into a volcano to mine heat from the bottom of the Earth's crust.
Yes, and go down 50 meters per day on average, depending on the type of bedrock you have. The length of this hole is more than 2,000 meters. The longest one here is about more than 3,000 meters. And up north, they are drilling a hole which is 4,000 meters. And when you consider in these areas, the crust is about 5 kilometers. So they're almost through the crust here.
So when people say we're running out of energy, that's not strictly true, is it?
No, not in the terms of geothermal energy, definitely. As long as we have active volcanoes in Iceland, we will have energy.
This local farm has taken full advantage of the plentiful Icelandic power for all of its operations. It's been tapping into a volcano for years, a volcano called Eyjafjallajökull.
So this is a source of geothermal heat.
Yes. And exactly 20 years ago, he drilled this hole. And you can see the water that comes out of it is 66 degrees.
This farm used the geothermal water to heat the whole operation, barns and all, while tapping the force of a glacial waterfall to run an old turbine built in the 1920s.
So any surplus energy that you generate gets put back into the national grid, is that right?
When he is producing more electricity than he needs, he sells it to the grid. When the farming operations are the most demanding for electricity, he has to buy off the grid, but it evens out, and what he pays for electricity for his whole farm, this is a big farm for Icelandic standards, it's less than his phone bill. So,
as long as the ground stayed quiet, this is a fortunate arrangement. But in April 2010, that fortune ran out. Eyjafjallajökull erupted. This picture was snapped just as the farm was being evacuated. Iceland's volcanoes are different than most others in the world. Because of their structure with glaciers capping the craters, when they explode, they're extra deadly. It's a triple whammy. When one starts to bubble, it starts to melt the ice on the underside of the glacier. That water, with nowhere to go, causes flash floods, and that's before the full force of the eruption. But then the ash starts to mix with the water. The pressure of the eruption lifts the glacier, and fast-moving walls of mud go speeding into the valleys. Finally, once the glacier on top of the crater has melted, a full-on volcanic eruption happens, showering the surrounding countryside with ash. The 2010 eruption covered farmers' fields with nearly 8 inches of ash. Now, they're useless, and will be until all the ash is incorporated into the soil. That could take several dozen years. In this land of great give and take, many rewards demand great sacrifices. But Icelanders have paid the ultimate price once. Are they prepared to do it again? The giant Eurasian plate is growing on its western flank. Directly underneath Iceland is a plume of magma forced out through the crack between tectonic plates. That magma is building land. Geologist Nick Iles has come here to see how the plate's growth gives Iceland immense stores of energy, enough to run the whole country with some to spare.
So what you do at the end of a hard day's doing geology?
Yes, definitely. And I guess Icelanders have been using the hot water since the beginning of settlement, of course. Bathed in it, cooked in it. And this is an excellent example here. The locals needed a pool to teach the kids to swim. It is hot water coming from out of the rocks here. And they just built these concrete walls and it filled on its own. And this they did in 1923.
So this is from a natural spring of hot water.
It's coming from the volcano above us. 85% of all houses in Iceland are heated with this. We are using this to generate electricity. So it's a big asset for the country.
So it's not all bad news living around volcanoes?
No.
This is one of the rewards.
Definitely not.
But do the rewards outweigh the risks? Icelanders know the risks they face from living in an explosive place. Yet the scale of the devastation, should the plume of magma below ground be released full force, is unimaginable. In 1783, when the volcano Laki last went off, lava fountains reached over 4,000 feet into the sky. The eruption lasted for 8 months, forever altering Iceland's southern shore. The destruction is vast and spreads in every direction. 130 craters opened up and spewed billions of tons of poisonous gas. Lava flows covered nearly 150,000 acres of farmland, forever making this landscape barren and lifeless. Now, the only thing that grows here is moss on the rocks.
Flowing down from our right to our left. It's literally a sea of lava, isn't it? The scale is unbelievable.
It is.
And this was the largest lava flow anywhere on the planet in the last 10,000 years.
The grasses from Laki poisoned the land and killed half the livestock. Famines followed. A quarter of Iceland's population were killed. The effect of the gas cloud could be felt as far as Japan. Laki was the deadliest volcano eruption in history.
Yeah. So this would have been a real scary place in 1783.
Yes, definitely. And after it sort of froze here, it became an obstacle for transportation. Of course, it destroyed a lot of farms. And I mean, there wasn't a decent road going through here until in the 80s.
Active farms were replaced with piles of rock. Rock that stands as a reminder of Iceland's precarious place atop a magma plume. Magma that shaped the landscape and the psyche.
eerie shapes.
Yeah, it relates strongly to the mythology here. People walk across, they see faces, they see trolls. It's not difficult to imagine walking through here in the night.
So this is a place they would have kept out of.
Yeah, they would have been scared of it.
So has this been embedded in the Icelandic culture?
Yeah, I would say so. Yeah, definitely. And in fact, the locals here still talk about the time before the fires and after the fires. It's still a time mark, sort of, for the local history here, even though it was as far back as 1783.
Icelanders know that with one eruption, this whole coast, in fact, the entire country, could be forever altered. The lava could pour right over the top of this, one layer on top of another.
So this is where fiery, red-hot magma has flowed out and cooled quite quickly.
Icelandic legends say this basalt is actually made out of petrified trolls.
Like organ pipes.
Yeah, they are.
These structures were made millions of years ago when highly fluid molten rock rapidly cooled and took on these shapes.
Top of the flow is up there and its bottom down here.
And the more rapid the cooling, the smaller the columns. And if it's very rapid, they can wind up forming a cube.
This entire landscape shows the telltale signs of the struggle within the earth. It's a stark reminder of the power at the tectonic boundaries. And the southern border of the Eurasian plate bears the massive scars of the assault. On the southwestern end of the Eurasian plate, more than 1,700 miles from Iceland, stand the majestic Alps. These mountains are icons. But geologists see the Alps as more than that. They see a story of tectonic violence and the Earth in the process of massive change. And the Alps are the casualties. Iceland is what they call the passive end of the Eurasian plate, where it's pushing away from another plate. This is the active end, the spot where the plate is being pummeled by neighboring landmasses.
Shall we?
Yes.
Geologist Nick Iles is with Stephen Johnson from the University of Victoria, who has spent his career studying the Alps.
Well, what a day, eh? Really.
Yeah, we're very lucky, aren't we? Yeah.
They've come here to find evidence of the Alps' violent birth from beneath the sea, the result of an epic collision.
All of this rock actually was deposited south of the European continent on oceanic crust.
Yeah.
Africa's moving north, and its northern end is colliding with Europe and giving us this mountain range.
So the rocks that we see in this lower part of the mountains were, again, marine rocks deposited in an ocean that's long ago ceased to exist.
Yeah.
As it was caught up.
Once there was an ocean between the continents of Europe and Africa, but then the plates collided. And when they did, the African landmass was actually forced underneath the ancient ocean, annihilating it in the process.
We know that the ocean started to close enough to affect Europe in the Jurassic. So some 180 million years ago, we start to see the European continent bending down, getting flooded by the ocean, and it's being dragged down by this oceanic plate sinking down beneath Africa. And as it sinks down, Africa advances on Europe, and the real collision, though, doesn't start until much later, less than 100 million years ago, probably around 60 million years ago. So it's a long process. The plates only move centimeters, maybe 10 centimeters a year, so it's snail-like compared to the way humans think and the way humans observe.
Yes, go on. Let's go and do some walking and look at some rocks. So
iconic view, isn't it?
God, just amazing. Yeah. You can see why they call a lot of their high mountains domes, teeth.
Yeah.
All these teeth were carved out of huge blocks of rock. After the Eurasian plate collided with Africa, their shifting caused the blocks to pile on top of each other. Then massive glaciers moved in and started sculpting the blocks into these mammoth mountains.
Yeah, it's worth remembering, isn't it, that the rocks that make up the mountain are old, but the mountain itself is almost brand new. It's been formed all the time by erosion.
Like, how long did it take to make a mountain like that?
Well, it's been cut by glacial erosion, and glaciers have only been in this area for the last couple of million years. So it's a very, very young mountain chain.
Yeah.
Geologists come here to see the force of Eurasia's collision with Africa, a force that brought the ocean floor to the surface. This rock here tells the entire story.
These are actually fascinating right here, the kind of shapes we're seeing in the rock here. Mm. Can you see this this little ridge that runs out here like this?
Yeah, it's a little rim.
Comes comes all the way back around. And there's another one here that goes out. I think these are pillow basalts that have been highly deformed.
Yeah, that have been squeezed and flattened.
Pillow basalts are formed by a volcanic eruption underwater. When the lava hits the cold water, the surface hardens into a pillow shape. The presence of old flattened pillow basalts here is more proof that this was once part of an ocean floor.
So this is conclusive evidence of the existence of a former ocean between Europe and Africa.
Mm-hmm. So this would have been crust sitting under 6 kilometers of water in an ocean. And then you notice, well, it's flattened, but also all of the micas and metamorphic minerals in here, these things have been highly metamorphosed. And in fact, you can see little pock marks in here that are little red garnets. So this is a rock we call eclogite, right?
Eclogite is a telltale clue of violent collision. Since it's formed in the mantle of the Earth, its presence here means this rock had to have been pulled down at least 22 miles, then forcibly hoisted to the surface.
You need to erode a lot of crust on top, don't you? It's a balance between cutting down into the rocks and more rock being brought up and exposed.
Yeah, I think you'd have a hard time, though, with just erosion getting this back to the surface. I think somehow the African plate must act like a bulldozer, and it caught a piece of the oceanic crust and brought it all the way back.
It's like an elevator.
Yeah, yeah.
When Europe and Africa collided, this elevator action brought marine rocks to the surface, forming much of the base of the Alps, the Grand Mountains of Europe, out of the rock of Africa. How big would the collision have to be to build a massive mountain range? The southwestern edge of the Eurasian Plain is marked by a 600-mile-long mountain range, the Alps. Mountains born of violent impact between land masses. At a little over 14,500 feet, the Matterhorn is one of the highest mountains in the Alps, straddling the border between Switzerland and Italy. But its origins lie somewhere else.
So we're sitting in front of a classic European mountain, an icon in Europe, but it's not actually made out of European rock, is it?
Yeah, it's amazing, right? We're sitting on these oceanic rocks down here that were the south margin of Europe. And that whole edifice that is the Matterhorn is, again, continental rock that sits above all of this oceanic rock. But it's not Europe. It's actually a piece of Africa that's been shoved right in over top of us back towards Europe.
Here. So that's ironic. We're on the border of Switzerland and Italy, but we're on the border of the European plate and the African plate, tectonically.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And how it gets so far in is amazing.
For African rock to have made it this far into Europe means the violent collision of Africa into the Eurasian plate must have been immense. millions of years later, the impact of that collision is ongoing. In geologic terms, the Earth is never truly settled. Even if mountains are only moving a fraction of an inch a year, they are still in motion. But a four-mile stretch of road through these mountains bridges ancient continents. The St. Bernard Tunnel cuts a path through the base of the Swiss Alps.
As we're going south into Italy, as we cross the international border, it's very close to the plate boundary too, isn't it?
Yeah, the border between Switzerland and Italy essentially is just about that boundary between the African rocks that have been pushed north over the European plate.
So the tunnel itself was cut right through the plate margin.
Yeah, the Alps still are a very active, seismically active region.
Yeah, which is another problem they had to contend with in building the tunnel, major earthquakes.
Yeah, maybe we shouldn't talk about that right now.
All right.
People have been living here in the Alps for as long as 15,000 years, but much of the region wasn't settled until 1,000 years ago. Before these tunnels made travel through the Alps possible, whole societies developed apart from each other in isolated mountain valleys.
Yeah, I'm always fascinated by the extent to which mountains have shaped human history. It's amazing, right? Different rocks, different fauna.
Feels like Africa.
Smells like Africa.
Actually, it should be a big marker up somewhere, shouldn't it? Saying you have crossed from Europe to Africa.
The Alps effectively insulate Italy from the cold weather up north.
It's amazingly warm compared to the north side of the Grand St. Bernard Tunnel.
Yeah, this warm air coming up from the Med has a noticeable effect on the climate. You see the snow lines much higher, it's much less snow.
Than on the Swiss side.
Yeah, so there are fewer glaciers on the Italian side, they're higher and smaller.
Mm. You can still see all the rocks actually descending into the earth, away to the south.
Yeah, this is all still African crust, isn't it? But it's been pushed up.
So this is all still stacked up into the Alps, pushing up and over European crust.
The Alps are evidence of the assault on the Eurasian plate. It's obvious on the edge of the plate, the front lines. But the impact of the collision had a ripple effect 1,000 miles away. The Eurasian plate is under assault from every direction by magma on the western edge and other land masses to the south and east. The edges of the plate are disfigured by this attack. But the gruesome marks of collisions past can be seen even far inland. This is Edinburgh in Scotland. It was built along a high glacial ridge, making one part of the city sit high above the rest. Edinburgh Castle is strategically elevated high above the city, built on the plug of an old volcano that last erupted 350 million years ago. The castle's base is a gigantic mound of volcanic rock. Its geology out in the open, and rock formations that beg to be studied. And in the 18th century, they inspired a theory that revolutionized science and changed our view of the Earth. The theory, formed in the 18th century by James Hutton, explained that the Earth had to be much older than most believed. Even more revolutionary was the concept that the mountains of the Earth were shaped by fire and not the biblical flood. This is called Hutton's section. It doesn't look like much, a seam in the rock just off a footpath. But it still draws students and geologists like Nick Iles.
And his big new idea was that some rocks had been formed in a molten state, weren't they? Because the dominant idea at that time was everything was produced by water.
Yeah.
Noah's flood, all that stuff.
The cliffside here is a vivid example of two different kind of rock blended together, as if one kind was injected into the other. In order for the two to be so intertwined, one type of rock had to have been superheated sometime, molten.
And if you go in closer and look at the two different rock types, the top one is made of small crystals, which is typical of volcanic rock, whereas the one beneath it is clearly made of separate particles and clasts and is kind of laminated in a way that the top one isn't. So you've clearly got two different rock types.
And so Hutton's vision was of this being liquid magma seeping in through the rocks and destroying the existing rock, bending and twisting it up. Close to the city of Edinburgh, within just a few hundred yards of his house, yeah, a great example he can bring people to, and he can say, look, here's evidence that it wasn't just layers on the seabed. Something else has happened here. There's different rocks formed at different times, and therefore the big jump, the Earth is ancient.
Younger rocks don't just rest on top of older rocks. They're separated by breaks in the time scale called unconformities. The story in the layers of rock didn't always make sense, since some of those layers had eroded. This put an end to the old biblical theory. The Earth could never have come ready-made out of a flood. The layering of the rock is most obvious when looking at the coast as a whole from the sea.
So this is where deep time was first discovered.
This is it, yeah. Mm. He needed a place to demonstrate it. And you can imagine I'm jumping off the boat here and finding certainly the best unconformity he'd ever seen, the best unconformity I've ever seen.
These rocks mean the Earth has a history. The amount of time it took to make these rocks, fold them, break them, stand them on end and lay new rocks over top, prove that the Earth is far more ancient than 6,000 years, as the Bible states.
Yeah, I mean, you get an excellent view here, the unconformity, the strongly vertical rocks here, very coloured, and then the sheets of red rocks on top.
Yeah, it's a fantastic view. One of the important pieces of evidence from here, the direct connection between the old rocks and the new.
And new rock is constantly forming. Most of the activity is at the edges of tectonic plates. But the British Isles lie in hundreds of miles from the nearest plate boundary. Yet they're being pushed inward by forces from the edges of the Eurasian plate. These rock formations are the result of a process started 400 million years ago.
Well, this whole area, we're in the far northern part of England, records the plate tectonic suturing, welding together of England, which used to be quite a separate little landmass, with Scotland. And that occurred about 400 million years ago when a previous ocean, previous to the Atlantic, closed, and that's called the Iapetus Ocean. So this area illustrates how the European plate got built. And there's been a whole succession of these little collisions to build up this larger mosaic that we now call the European plate.
All those small collisions had a big impact. The coast of the English Channel is a prime example of the intensity of the mid-plate forces, strong enough to heave the shale cliffs off the seafloor. Each sliver of shale represents a layer of sediment laid down 175 million years ago. Geologists can even tell how old these shales are by looking at the types of fossils trapped between them. Fossils are a permanent timestamp for the age of the rock.
Yeah, these are pages. Imagine a book just turned on its edge. We've got the pages exposed right here in front of us. So as we go up through the pages, we're going through the book, we're going through the chapters. And instead of numbers on each page, we have what we call zone fossils, which are consistent groups of fossils found within each layer. And they may be very small microfossils, such as in these shales. These were muds on the ocean floor. Or they may be large ammonites. But either way, they change through time. And by recognizing the distinct form of the microfossil or the macrofossil, we can actually put a relative age on these rocks. We can say this layer is older than one that's younger.
Dating these fossils gives scientists insight into the conditions of the region at any given time. Marine fossils in rock offer indisputable proof of an ancient ocean, that this area was once underwater. The bluffs of Lyme Regis are ripe with fossils. So many have been found in the layers of rock here that the region has been renamed the Jurassic Coast. Steve Davies is a local fossil hunter. He's more familiar with the deposits in these rocks than anyone.
It's just full of them, isn't it?
And we can see, just looking at this, we've got quite a range of different shapes and sizes of the beasties. But as you go up through geological time in the Jurassic, there are thousands of different species, varying in terms of size and the ribs that grow on it. The coiling, sometimes they're tightly coiled, sometimes they're really open coiling.
So there are important concepts about time and almost barcoding different rock layers by their fossils.
You can recognise distinctions in those ammonites, the zones and the subzones, with a resolution of maybe a quarter of a million years of time. That's like being able to recognise an instant in our day. It's amazing.
So you can put a rate on evolution itself?
You can do that, yeah. It's the fundamental bit of geology that you can categorise a body of rock by its fossils and track it across. Same fossils, same rock. You don't need to be thinking in terms of Darwin and evolution and millions of years. Just same fossils, same rocks.
Just a little further down the coast, and the rock formation looks very different.
Well, these rocks have been body checked by Africa coming up from the south. Think of a bow wave in front of a huge tanker. Think of Africa as a giant tanker coming up north. So right close to the bow, you've got intense folding in the Alps. A little bit further away, you have smaller waves. But essentially, it's a big bow wave on a giant scale as one continent plows into another plate. And it gently rippled the rocks to give us these folds and the gently rolling countryside. When I first came here, this was in the 60s, and geology was really very much concerned with stratigraphy, the relative age dating of rocks. Rocks are older than these are younger than those, and so on. Coming back today and seeing this, I see this in a completely different light. It's not just layers anymore, it's the deposits of a now extinct ocean. And I can now put this in a plate tectonic content and look at this in its global perspective. So it's been this tremendous development of plate tectonic science. And the revelation has really been of the recognition that continents come together, they form supercontinents, and then they break up. And that's a sort of basic cycle, maybe 250, 300 million years, maybe a little bit more, of most of Earth history.
If hundreds of miles away from the plate's edges is subject to enough pressure to contort rock like this, then the plate boundaries, where the African and Eurasian plates collide, and a magma plume menaces Iceland, are at nature's mercy. The forces at work here are enough to heave mountains and merge continents, spew fire from the core of the earth, and bring civilizations to their knees. And even away from the front lines, they radically reshape the landscape and inspire a new science. Europe is a place besieged from every angle. All its